how can a brain want anything? Especially when they're this small. I mean, when it's 80,000 neurons or 100,000 neurons, how can a little cluster of cells like that want things? But they clearly do. I mean, they clearly kind of work to get the things that they want in a very systematic way. Mm-hmm. And that's what I want to understand. You see this guy? He's going to try to capture that one. So that's a prey capture event. All of the little movements, every little tail movement, kind of brings the fish closer to the prey in a very precise manner. And it's not understood how that actually happens in the brain. Like how can the visual input be transformed in the brain into very precise motor output that allows these fish to capture prey?
We're recording the activity of thousands of individual neurons in the brain while the fish are performing a behavioral task. In our case, we're particularly interested in how they hunt for food. You know, the brain is made up of a circuit. It would be just like an electrical circuit. It's a cluster of neurons that are connected to each other. And the circuits in the brain, in our brains or in the brain of fish, perform certain computations. So they receive an input, compute something on that input, and then send out an output to the muscles of the body or to another circuit that's going to do something else. And so we're trying to watch what the circuits in the brain are doing as the fish is watching a stimulus or as it's deciding whether to swim left or right, and then trying to be able to eventually model what those circuits are computing. The first most important part is to keep the brain still so we can watch it. We embed the fish in a little in kind of a gelatin-like substance to stabilize its brain, but its eyes and its tail are free to move.
And so the fish sits in its dish looking at this little light, and the light is moving either on the left side or on the left side or on the right side. The fish will make tail motions that go in the direction of the stimulus, which if the fish was swimming freely, it would actually take it towards the prey. And here you can actually see the individual neurons kind of blink on and off. So the cell bodies in this case are up here. It's a little bit hard to see, but you can see them when they light up. And then there are little axons that lead down into this big area of neuropil, it's called. It's axons and dendrites that connect to each other. And that's where most of the action happens. So when the cell bodies light up, you're seeing kind of individual cells firing. Here it's kind of a mess, a big bundle of neurons firing. And in this video, every time you see this kind of big burst of light here, that's because I've flashed an LED close to the eye of the fish. So it's just like having a light turn on close to you. And this region that we're recording from is the visual system of the fish.
Once we've mapped out which neurons are doing what and where they're located, the real question is, how are they doing this? And to get to the answer of how, we have to know how those neurons are connected to each other. And the only way we can really do that is by mapping the anatomy at nanometer resolution with an electron microscope. The idea is to cut through that brain slice by slice and take an image of every single slice throughout the whole brain. And the slices are extremely thin, on the order of only a few tens of nanometers, many, many times thinner than a human hair. Because we're cutting so thin, it means that we have to collect tens of thousands of sections just to collect a single fish brain. But it's at a high enough resolution that we can then follow every single neuron through the brain and figure out which neurons were connected to each other.
These are the eyes, these are the retina, and the different layers, the photoreceptors, and then the kind of deeper layers of the retina. This is the jaw, or the mouth and the jaw, and up here is brain tissue. This is the cell in the middle of the whole thing, and this layer is the nuclear membrane, and then just outside of that is the cell body membrane itself. All of these smaller circles are individual dendrites or axons. So these black dots are individual synaptic vesicles that contain neurotransmitters. The thicker layer here is an actual synapse. And I have some fish that are really good at it, and they always bend exactly the way they're supposed to, and they do it a lot. And then I have another fish which bends in the wrong direction or doesn't bend at all, and it doesn't try to acquire this little dot. And I want to know, what's the difference between those two fish? And then I put the fish through this electron microscope and I look at the neurons that we know are involved in prey capture, and I see that in the good fish and the well-performing fish, they were receiving lots of these little synaptic connections at the right place that they, that these neurons would need to be activated. And in the other fish, those synapses maybe hadn't developed yet. And I could count them, I could say exactly where they are, and we might even be able to create some sort of model of it eventually to describe quantitatively how this prey capture behavior is executed by the brain. To get to that point, we need to have this kind of data, but in 3D. And so Kevin here has generated previously a 3D image of the same region of the brain. This is a cube of tissue. This was just one slice, just one level, and this is just many, many, many slices like that put together and played in sequence like a video. This brain is never going to be used for the 3D electron microscopy, but the technique that I used to generate this brain is something I'm writing down very, very precisely. So I know how to generate a brain that looks like this now.
When you see that, when you see what the brain is doing, just with spontaneous activity in a brain, you see neurons flashing on and off constantly. It looks like, yeah, like you're looking up at the sky and seeing stars blink on and off. The fact that you can just watch your computer screen and see this happening in real time, you don't have to do any complicated analysis to see these signals anymore. You don't have to average across many, many trials. It's amazing.